Hey, good morning, everybody. Oh, I heard some of you guys say good morning. I hope everyone had a wonderful Thanksgiving, and we are looking forward to an awesome, awesome Christmas season. Is everybody ready for Christmas? I know I am. I'm super ready. Now that Thanksgiving is over, I'm like, woohoo, Christmas. That's amazing. Hey, why don't you guys go ahead and stand up? We're going to start off this Christmas season. We're going to start with some Christmas songs. Let's put our hands together as we sing Joy to the World. I think everybody knows this song. I want to hear everybody's voices. Let's lift them up.
Joy.
Good morning. You may be seated. Good to see you guys. Thank you, worship team. Thank you to the new folks up here on stage. Well, one was back from college, Olivia, and also Jennifer Barros was up here on stage. So, Jennifer, thank you for joining the worship team for the first time today.
Woohoo!
There you go. We're so glad you're here with us. I'm Jason Whiter. I'm the pastor at Grace. This is my good friend.
Hey, I'm Shelby Pfister. Blessed to be here.
Amen. Awesome. So we've just got a few things to share with you this morning. First of all, you have this QR code up on the screen. So I would love it if you take your phones out, put it on the camera app, scan that code, and it'll take you to the online check-in. We would just love to know who's with us today. And if you have any questions about anything, if you have concerns, prayer concerns, requests, you can leave that on the check-in, the online check-in. If you are new with us today, and we hope that we have some new friends with us, we would especially love for you to fill this out. It just helps us know who's with us. If you're a first-time guest, we get to know you a little bit that way. You can share a little bit more about yourself, and we'd love to reach out and continue that welcome to you. But we're so honored that you, if you're a first-timer, are here, and everybody's here. We love worshiping God together here at Grace on Sunday mornings. A couple other things. We have a special weekend coming up at the beach, and it's going to be fun, December the 10th and 11th. On the 10th, we have a beach outreach. That's Saturday morning. It starts at 8:30, and more information is on the website. Just an opportunity for us to be there and say hello to the beachgoers early in the morning, to provide bottles of water, invitations to Christmas here at Grace, and just be available for conversation and prayer as the Lord leads and provides that opportunity. So if you'd like to join us, we'd love to have you. So that's the 10th. The next day, we're having some baptisms out of the beach. So a good special weekend for beach time. That's going to be 3:30 in the afternoon. And so if you have not been baptized and are interested in being baptized and making that step and commitment, I would love nothing more than to connect with you, speak to you about that, and line it up if it works out for you to be there. So 3:30, December the 11th. And these are both taking place at South Inlet Park, which is about a mile east of here, just down Camino. So for the baptism, the whole congregation is invited. So even if you're not being baptized or have a friend or family member, we'd love for you to be there just in celebration of the church family. So we're excited about that. Shelby, what you got?
Hey, folks, family. So now that we have given thanks, now it is time to spruce up the campus.
There you go.
So Tuesday, starting at 5:30, we are having a decoration party where we're going to add some sparkle to the Grace campus. How fabulous would it be as we are putting up lights and bows and Christmas trees that we pray over this whole campus, so that every person that enters the campus during the holiday season can feel the peace, love, and joy of the season and of the Savior's birth. So that is this Tuesday, 5:30. Start in here. Everybody have a little nibble. Wish Kelly a happy birthday. And then she will assign some tasks, and everybody, we can get this campus shining for the Savior's birth. And then December 9th, there is a very special sisterhood night. It's going to be cookies and a movie. How super fun. Cookies and cookie decorating supplies will be provided, but we need you to register. So that is December 9th from 6 to 9. Please register. And for a bunch of other things, you can go to graceboca.org.
Yes, we always want to point you to the website. There's a lot of this information and much more along the lines of Christmas. To help with those decorations, we are going to be providing poinsettias. So if you would like to give a gift of a poinsettia or a number of poinsettias in memory of or in honor of a loved one, you can find that info on the website as well and go through that online process to purchase those poinsettias, just to help decorate the church and to remember and to celebrate those whom you have loved and still love. So poinsettias, and then let's see, what was my last thing? Oh, Christmas services. Yes, there's a lot of things on my mind today. Christmas services, all that info is on the website under Christmas at Grace. So we just hope that you will seek that out and be in prayer, like Shelby said, about the whole Christmas season. It's exciting starting that today. Just be in prayer about God opening your heart to the wonder of Christmas. That's our theme for the month. And not only your heart, the heart of others in your family, others of your friends and neighbors, coworkers. And if God puts it on your heart for you to invite one of them or some of them, we certainly hope that you will. It's going to be a special season. We're excited about it. One other thing, I just want to make a special recognition today. Today is the 5-year anniversary for Kim Reed being on our staff. So I think Kim's with the kids right now. Is Kim in here by chance? Yeah, so we acknowledged her. We gave her a little collage with a picture of kids thanking her, and we're just excited and just appreciate so much those 5 years that Kim has given to God. She loves Jesus so much, loves the children so much, and
Amen. God, you are faithful through every season, Lord. We love you, Jesus. We love you, God. We've come to worship you today, to lift up your name, God, the name that is above every name.
You are a healer, then you are a healer.
Come on, church, he is faithful in every season. I know that a lot of us are going through different circumstances and difficulties, but God remains the same. He never changes. He's always the same, church. And that's one thing that I think I spoke to you guys a few weeks ago. You know, God doesn't move, right? We move. Our life shifts around. We get distracted by work. We get distracted by Netflix. We get distracted by a bunch of things in our lives, right? And we don't really give that focus to God. God is the same. Those same miracles that you saw in the Old Testament, those same things are still happening today. God is still moving. He can still heal you. He can still save you. He can still move in your life. He can still give you peace. He can still give you love. So we're gonna sing that bridge one more time that says, you know, you heard your prayers, or you heard your children then. You hear your children now. So we're gonna declare that today, and I just encourage you, sing it with all you got, church. Believe it. He's still the same. He's still the same. You heard your children then. You hear your children now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You answer prayers back. And you will answer now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You were providing then. You are providing now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You moved in power then.
Singing that song and trusting in his
promise and trusting in his presence. So as I said earlier, we're so glad that you're here and so glad always that God is here with us as we worship. He's here with us as we worship in the day-to-day. Whatever it is we're doing, that same God is the God who's here with us on Sunday mornings. Same God with us when you go to work or school on Monday morning. Same God when you're with your family, friends, loved ones, with those whom you don't know. He's the same God right there with you and for you. So much hope in that truth and in that promise. So again, we're glad that you're here. I'm wondering this morning what you wonder about when you wonder about things, all right? So you pick up on that. I wonder what you wonder about when you wonder about things. I wonder what you think about when you get lost in your thoughts. You know, when you're just meditating, thinking, what do you get lost in your thoughts about? And what are you curious about when the wheels in your mind start spinning and turning and churning? What are the things that you're curious about that you wonder about? You know, maybe for you, for example, you wonder what it might have been like to live 100 years ago. And maybe you wonder what it might be like to live 100 years from now. I don't know. Maybe some of you wonder about those sorts of things. Or if you're younger, maybe you wonder what you're going to be when you get older. Wonder what you're going to be when you grow up. Or wonder maybe who you're going to marry. Or if you're going to have kids, how many kids, what your kids are going to be like, those sorts of things. Or if you're older, maybe you wonder, you know, how things might have been if this had happened differently at some pivotal point along the way in your journey. Or if that had happened differently at some key defining moment in your life. I wonder, do you wonder about just the infinite nature of the universe? You ever wonder about that? Just, gosh, just blows your mind. You ever wonder about the infinite nature of God? Do you ever wonder about God's plan and his plan and purpose for you, and whether you're living out into his plan, his purpose for your life? Do you ever wonder about heaven? You ever wonder what heaven is going to be like? I wonder what you wonder about when you wonder about things. And then there's also the other side of wonder, you know, that side of wonder that's more the awe and the amazement and the astonishment. It just fills your mind with that sense of wonder. You know, they talk about the wonders of the world. There's the seven natural wonders of the world. There's the wonders of the ancient man-made world. There's also the wonders of the modern man-made world. All these wonders of the world, the things that you see with your eye that spark wonder, awe, amazement, and astonishment in your minds. And for me, I don't know about you, but sometimes just technology sparks wonder in my mind. I'm just blown away by just technology in general. One of the things that I think hit me more than other types of technology was just the GPS. Y'all remember when the GPS came out around 20 years ago, however long it's been now? It used to be, it wasn't on the phones. It was like a little contraption that you'd have in your car. And I just could not believe that this little contraption could take you from point A to point B, step by step, turn by turn, with a little person talking to you along the way. Anybody remember being just blown away by that? How that could be possible? And now it's just taken for granted, you know? And so that used to surprise me and fill me with wonder. And I'm just thinking also today about, some of you have a computer around your wrists and the watches that you're wearing right now that likely are so much more powerful, so much stronger than computers that used to be in entire rooms. I don't know, 50, 60 years ago, maybe entire floors of buildings, the computer in a lot of people's watches are more powerful than those computers back then. It just blows me away. It just fills me with wonder to stop and think about that kind of technology and where it's going to be 50, 100 years from now, right? And then what about the wonder of conception? What about the wonder of childbirth? You know, especially if you are the parent, those first moments, those first days, you are just filled and flooded with the miracle of it all. Your life is flooded with the miracle of it all. Just overwhelmed with that awe and amazement and astonishment side of wonder. So you're thinking about the two sides of wonder, the wonder of just the curiosity and the questions, and also the wonder in terms of the awe and amazement and astonishment. So I wonder, you think about the wonder of conception, the wonder of childbirth, I wonder what Mary, the mother of Jesus, must have wondered all those years ago. We're going to read a part of her story today from Luke chapter 1. So I'm going to start with Luke chapter 1, verse 26. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God
to a city of Galilee, named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed or engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and he said, "Greetings, O favored one. The Lord is with you." But she was greatly troubled at this saying. She tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and you will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great," "and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom there will be no end." And Mary said to the angel, "How will this be? How can this be, since I am a virgin?" And the angel answered her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you. The power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. And behold, your relative Elizabeth in her old age has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month with her who is called barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." And Mary said, "Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. Mary said, "How will this be? How can this be?" I mean, you think about it. Here she was, this otherwise random young woman, minding her own business, doing her own thing, when all of a sudden one day this angel appears and tells her that she's found favor with God. I mean, it's not your normal everyday kind of encounter and interaction, right? And so Mary's afraid, and the angel says, "Don't be, Mary. Don't be afraid. You're going to bear a child. You're going to bear the Son of God." And Mary's thinking to herself, "Hold on, you said don't be afraid, and now I'm even more afraid. How is this even possible? How can this be? How can I bear a child, any child, much less the Son of God, when there's no daddy involved, when there's no father, when there's no husband? I'm engaged, but I'm not married. How can this be?" Mary said. She was greatly troubled, the Bible says. She was perplexed. She was confused. Can you just imagine what Mary must have been wondering in all that? I wonder what she wondered in that moment on that day and on that night. And then also what she must have wondered pretty much every moment and every day and every night thereafter. It's like Abraham and Sarah years earlier, well beyond childbearing years, promised by God to have a child. And just like Zechariah and Elizabeth, Mary's relative, as we read right there, about the same time, 6 months earlier, had also been well beyond childbearing years and yet promised to have a child. And this angel reminded Mary of what God had promised to Abraham and Sarah all those years ago and what God was now doing for Zechariah and for Elizabeth. What did he say? He said, "Nothing will be impossible with God." Not one thing, not one single thing has ever been, is now, or ever will be impossible with God. And Mary, having been reassured of that promise of God, what does she do? She surrendered. She surrendered in faith, trust, and obedience. And she said, "Here I am, God. Here I am, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Even though she did not have all the answers that she may have wanted or asked about, even though she didn't know what it all meant exactly, even though she didn't know exactly how it was all going to unfold in the long run, even though she surely still wondered about all sorts of things, she gave herself to God and to the purpose and the plan that God had for her. She made that step, or you might say, probably should say, she took that leap of surrender. She took that step, that leap of surrender, and God took her from basically one state of mind to another state of mind, from one place to another place, from one side of wonder to another, the other side of wonder, from the side of wonder where she was wondering what it all was all about, wondering how can this be, wondering what it all meant, to the side of wonder that where she was filled with that awe and amazement and astonishment and adoration at who God was and at what God had done and would do. She went from that place of, "How can this be?" And God took her to the place of, "Here I am. Here I am, God, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word. Have you ever said or thought to yourself about the things of God? How can this be? Have you ever wondered to yourself about the things of God, or wondered yourself about the things of the Bible, or wondered to yourself about the plan and the purpose of God, and the plan and purpose of God for your life, and thought to yourself, how can this be? How really can this be? How can it be that this story from this book that was written all those years ago about this baby who was born on the other side of the world all those years ago, how can it be that this story from this book all those years ago could make a difference all these years later? How could it be that it could make a difference in my life all these years later? How can it be? Have you ever wondered that? You wonder what it's all about. Maybe for you, that is the wonder of Christmas right now. It's that side of wonder. The wondering what it's all about, wondering what it all means, wondering what it all means for you. Maybe even wondering if it's all real and true and legit. Wondering how can this be? Remember, we read it and we talked about it. Mary was greatly troubled at first. She was perplexed. She was confused. And maybe that's where you sometimes are. Maybe that's where you are right now. Troubled, confused, and perplexed. You're just trying to sort through it all, trying to fit it all together. It doesn't all make perfect, logical, rational sense to you right now. And you're just having a hard time if you're honest with yourself. Maybe that's you. Maybe that's where you are right now. For some people, that's the end of it. They move right on past, lay it aside, and keep going forward. Because some people say, I have to see it in order to believe it. Or they say, I have to fully, completely comprehend, understand, grasp, and be able to explain it in order to believe it. And so if that's you today, friends, if that's you this season, if that's you this Christmas, if that's where you are, if you're on that side of wonder, wondering how can this be, wondering what it's all about, wondering what it all means and what it means for you, then I pray that God will take you from that side of wonder to the other side of wonder, the other side of the wonder of Christmas, that side where he fills you with awe and amazement and adoration and astonishment at who he is and at what he has done and still is yet to do. That side of wonder where you are just filled and flooded with that awe, amazement, astonishment, and adoration at that promise that nothing is impossible with God, that nothing, not one single thing ever has been, is now, or ever will be impossible with God. I pray that God takes you from one side of the wonder of Christmas to the other side of the wonder of Christmas. Because maybe right now, or recently, maybe you've been feeling like something or a number of things are impossible in your life. Or if not totally impossible, very near impossible. Maybe you're here today in church or you're watching the church service online and you're thinking to yourself, it is impossible that God would love me. God, you know, I know me. I know what I've been through in life. I know what I've done. It is impossible or near impossible that God would ever love me. It's impossible that God would ever forgive me all the things that I've done, thought, or said. It's impossible that God would save me. It's impossible or very near impossible that God could or would ever use me, even me. And maybe you're thinking some of those things. Or maybe you're thinking, you know, it's impossible that this hurting relationship could ever be healed. It's impossible this hurting relationship could ever be restored. Whatever relationship that might be. Or if ultimately that relationship does not get healed, does not get restored, maybe you're thinking to yourself, oh, if that doesn't happen, if it doesn't get restored, it's impossible that I could ever move forward in a positive way after that. Or maybe you're thinking, it's impossible that you're ever going to get out of the storm that you're in, whatever storm that is, that you're ever going to make it out of the mess that you're in, whether it's a mess you've gotten yourself into or a mess is caused by something or someone else. It's impossible that you're ever going to get out of it. Or you think it's impossible I'm ever going to get over that mountain that's right in front of me. It's been in front of me for a long time. It's impossible I'll ever get over it. Or it's impossible to overcome those doubts that are sinking me. Or maybe you're thinking it's impossible I'll ever really know, I'll ever really experience what they talk about at Christmas so much, that joy, and that hope and that peace and that love. It's such a far reach, such a far grasp, maybe you're thinking it's impossible that you'll ever reach it, that you'll ever grasp it, you'll ever experience. And maybe you're thinking, it's impossible. How can it be? Because I know Christmas. I've been with Christmas my whole life. I've done Christmas. I've heard the Christmas story, the Christmas message over and over and over again. How could it be possible that, excuse me, that I might see something, I might experience something, that I may encounter something new and different this Christmas out of and among all the other Christmases? Maybe you're thinking it's impossible or near impossible. I just want to say it's the same way that God made something new and different happen for Abraham and for Sarah. He can make happen for you and for me. The same way God made something new and different happen for Zechariah and for Elizabeth. The same way God made something new and different and incredible happen through the miraculous virgin birth of this baby who changed the world forever. The very same way that God made something new and different happen when that baby grew to become the man who conquered and crushed sin, the power of sin, by dying on a cross. The same way he made something new and different happen when that man conquered and crushed the power of death by rising from the grave. Nothing, not one single thing has ever been, is now, or ever will be impossible with God. The question is, do you believe that? Do you believe that nothing is impossible with God when it is a part of God's plan? Do you believe that? Do you trust that? Because like we said, sometimes people say I have to see it in order to believe it. Or I have to fully understand, grasp and comprehend and be able to explain it in order to believe it. Maybe, and I've heard this said before, maybe you have too, maybe instead of seeing in order to believe, we need to flip that around and instead believe in order to more fully see. To believe in order to more fully understand, to more fully comprehend, to more fully grasp, to more fully understand. You see what I mean? Instead of seeing in order to believe, maybe God's leading us to believe in order to more fully see. I want you to think about that. Excuse me. Thank you very much. I just want you to think about that today and this season. About 20 years ago, our family lived up in the mountains of Virginia, and we lived near this ski slope, this small ski slope called Wintergreen. We're 15, 20 minutes away, and so I would go over there, you know, several times a year just for a little bit of skiing, and I remember being so impressed with this particular ski slope's adaptive ski program. And so it was their way of helping people with disabilities be able to ski. And they had lots of different programs for all sorts of different disabilities, but the one that impressed me the most were the blind skiers. I'm serious. The blind skiers, I see it all the time. And so skiing is not necessarily easy as it is. If you've ever skied, you know what I mean, especially on the East Coast when it's basically like a sheet of ice over here, not the powder of the West Coast. But So it's not easy as it is with complete full eyesight. Just imagine, you know, going over the crest of that hill and going down a mountain without being able to see at all. And the way it worked was that there were these trained professionals, these instructors who would ski right beside the blind skier the whole way, calling out instructions as they went down the mountain. They would turn left, turn right, slow down, stop, all those sorts of things. And so in order for it to work, the blind skier had to believe in that instructor. In other words, they had to believe that instructor was there. They couldn't see them, obviously. They could hear them, but they had to believe that instructor was right there beside them all the way down the mountain. And not just to believe in that instructor, they had to believe that instructor. They had to believe the instructions that the instructor was telling them, because that could lead to a nightmare if they give them the wrong instructions, right? So they had to believe in and also to believe that instructor in order to be able to ski down the mountain. Like we said, sometimes instead of seeing in order to believe, sometimes instead of fully understanding in order to believe, sometimes we need to believe in order to more fully see. Sometimes we need to believe in order to more fully understand and to grasp and to comprehend and to explain. At first, Mary said, how can this be? How can this be? You know, she was on that side of wonder. But then by the grace of God and God's work in her young life, God took her to the place, the other place, the other side of wonder. And she believed, she trusted, and she responded by the grace of God and faith and in faithfulness. God took her to that place of awe and amazement and astonishment and adoration at who God is and what God has done, to where Mary responded in humility and with obedience. Here I am. Here I am. Your servant, God. Let it be with me. Let it be with me according to your word. I wonder what Mary wondered about when she wondered about things, you know? You ever stopped and thought about that? I wonder what Mary must have wondered about. I wonder if Mary knew that her baby boy would one day walk on water. Think she ever wondered about that? What this baby boy that was now conceived inside of her would one day do? I wonder if she ever knew, wondered if this baby boy would one day walk on water. I wonder if Mary knew that this baby boy would one day save our sons and daughters. I wonder if Mary knew that her baby boy would give sight to a blind man. I wonder if Mary knew, if she had any idea that her baby boy would calm a storm with his hand. I wonder what Mary wondered. You know, we don't know all of that. It's not all of what she must have wondered. It's not recorded for us in the Bible, but I don't know what she wondered, but I know what she said. We read it today. You know what she said. She said, here I am. She said, I am the servant of the Lord. She said, let it be with me according to your word. And this is my prayer today, friends. My prayer today is, God, help me to say the same thing. Help me not only to say the same thing, God, help me to believe the same thing. Help me to mean the same thing. Help me to live the same thing. And not just me, God, every one of us, every person in the room, every person watching online, every believer, or by the grace of God, soon to be believer in this city and around the globe. God, help me to help us to say and to believe and to mean and to live the same thing. Here I am. Here I am, your servant, God. Let it be with me according to your word. Take me from that one side of wonder where it's all just wondering if it's all real, legit, and true, wondering how can this be? Is it possible? What difference is it made? Is the story of Christmas make in the world? What difference can it make in my life? Take me from that side of wonder, God, to the other side of wonder where you fill and flood my life with awe and amazement and astonishment and adoration at who you are and at what you have done and what you are yet to do. Fill me with that side of wonder, God, at your promise that nothing, not one single thing ever has been, is now, or ever will be impossible with you. Amen.
Mom, Dad, I'm pregnant. You think she said it like that? Almost like, here it is, deal with it. And by the way, your grandson, he'll be the son of the Most High God. Yeah, how do you even say that? The angel told her not to be afraid. And Mary, well, we know she was faithful. So maybe she just decided to believe him. That whatever was about to happen, she was gonna be okay. When do you think she realized that she hadn't accidentally found herself in this situation, but she'd actually been chosen for it? Because when you know that you're chosen, that's when you know that you're loved. And when you're loved, well, that gives you the kind of confidence you need to walk through doors everyone else wouldn't dare go through. But Mary dared. She dared to trust God as she watched him give life, then give it up for our sakes. And it all, in the unforgettable miracles and the very scary moments, She trusted his will rather than demanded answers. Walked forward instead of turned back. Stepped out instead of hit. Kind of makes you want to be like that little girl, huh? So do not be afraid. Listen carefully, for I proclaim to you good news that brings great joy to all the people. Today, your Savior is born in the city of David. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in strips of cloth and lying in a manger. Glory to God in the highest, and peace on earth to men on whom his favor rests.
So much for coming this beautiful Sunday and a wonderful start to our Christmas season. please put on your calendars our Christmas Eve services, our Christmas Day service, and especially this coming Tuesday. I would love to have this place filled with all of you to help decorate the campus. If you could, make sure you register for the event so we know how much food to order. If you don't register, just come on by. We want to fill this place and decorate it, make this campus look Christmas ready, and have fun fellowshipping. Have a wonderful week. Come back next week. Invite a friend. We love you guys. God bless.